Today's tinkering is accompanied by Wild River Wild Rice Red Ale from Interwick Brewing Company. These guys are located in Gimli, Manitoba, which also happens to be the home of the Crown Royal Distillery. That is interesting. Anyway, tonight I want to mess with some more DMX lighting, DMX 512 lighting, which is, as I've mentioned in the past, the standard for controlling stage lighting. This is anything but a professional stage light, but it does speak that protocol, so I'm going to use that as my test subject. And to control it, I'm going to try using this Raspberry Pi Zero. Now, one of the limitations of the DMX 512 standard is that you can only control 512 lights or functions on lights on a single channel, which they call universes. So with this USB to XLR adapter here from my computer and some control software, which in my case is QLC Plus, I can control this light, which has eight channels, or takes up eight channels, and a handful more. But if I'm running pixels in this, using a device like this thing, see previous video up there, we start running out of channels really quickly, because each LED is an RGB LED, so that takes up three channels per LED. This particular board here, I think, has 64 LEDs on it, so 64 times 3, and you can see what happens. You start running out of channels pretty quickly. So what I want to do is use some code that I found on this little Raspberry Pi, which, being a Pi Zero, is what, $15? Super cheap in the grand scheme of things, and have that translate from an internet-based or an ethernet-based protocol called Artnet to DMX to control additional stuff, so I can have some channels on this and some channels on this without having to have multiple cables run. And the added benefit is this also adds a wireless component to it. But first, we have to get a little bit of software set up on the SD card for the Pi. For most of this project, this experimenting, I'm going to be following this Instructables article here, which I will link to down below, of course. All the links to everything is going to be down there. In the article, they're using a Pi 3 or 4 or 5, the larger ones, the ones that are going for like $75 to over $100 these days. And they're using this hat, which there's links to it from here as well. But I'm going to, as I said, use the Pi 0 because it's super cheap, and see if I can make it work with some bits of hardware that I got kicking around here. So DMX 512 describes the data packets, the data format, but the physical interface uses RS-485 bus. And for that, we can use one of these RS-485 adapter boards, or we can use the MAX-485 chip, which is what that little chip is on there. But for this experiment, I'm just going to use the adapter board because it's easy and it's quick. We'll just use the Raspberry Pi OS imaging tool, which you can get from the Raspberry Pi website. In here, we'll choose to install the Pi OS Lite 32-bit version. We don't need a desktop environment, so that's a nice small download. We'll select the adapter that has our SD card in it. Pick a couple of other options from down here. I'm going to give it a host name. I will set up a username and password. I'll set up my Wi-Fi, pick my Wi-Fi country settings, save all that, and then write it to the SD card and plug that back into the Pi. And if that all worked, we should be able to log into the thing. There we go. So scrolling down in the Instructables, there's a few other things that you have to set up in here. Just follow the magic footsteps. It worked for me first try. I didn't have to fight with it or anything. It's a little bit of minor messing around to do, but it's not too bad. Next, you have to install the software package called OLA, which is Open Lighting Architecture. This is a powerful little open source program. It allows the Raspberry Pi or wherever else you've installed it to talk to all kinds of different lighting protocols and translate between them and whatnot. Oh, I didn't notice this before. You can even go directly to WS2801 and presumably WS2812 then too. I think I'll save that for a future video, though. That's not exactly what I was planning for today. But as you can see, it can talk Artnet over the Ethernet. It can talk various DMX over USB. So if we were to plug that USB adapter of mine into it, we should be able to use that. But it can also handle some various serial protocols, which is what exactly what we're going to be doing. As you can see here, it's using UART DMX. And there is setting up the serial port on the Pi to handle that. Should be able to just go to the built-in website once we're done with all those commands and whatnot. And there it is. So the first thing you have to do in here is add a universe, which I've already done experimenting with it. But basically, let's look at it here. It is using the native DMX on that serial port there. It is called itself Universe 1, and the name of the universe is Pi. And that's all we need to set up in that universe. Go down here and make sure that the UART native DMX is functioning, and it is. And with that, then we can go to the built-in basic DMX console, and let's go back to hardware world. Here's my little RS-45 interface again. I've got a cable for data in, power, 5 volts and ground, and then I've got the DMX connection going out to here. I'll just quickly connect it to the Raspberry Pi. The pins we need off the Pi are one of the 5 volt power, a ground, and the transmit data, which is on pin 8. I'm going to choose pin 2 and use pin 8 because I have to. And instead of using this ground, because the pins are too close together, I'm going to use this one, but either one would work. And so, with that all connected up and the cable connected to the light, we go over to the built-in, just simple DMX console in OLA and pull up a couple of faders. We should start seeing some light happen here. There we go. There's blue. There we go. All of them, and then the master dim. If we want to, we can turn on the strobing mode. Anyway, yeah, so that works, although you wouldn't want to use it this way. You could, and you have access to all 512 channels here if you wanted to. But of course, this is a really low-tech, inefficient way of doing it. But if that's just your basic needs, you could easily do that. However, there are other things we can do with this. So in the universe setup, we made sure we set both the output port to the UART native DMX, which is what we were using there. Then we also set up an input port using Artnet. And there is the IP address of the Raspberry Pi. So with that all set up, we can go into our QLC or Q8 controller, go to its inputs and outputs. We'll set up Universe 1 in there for an output on Artnet. So we're outputting from 10.0.0.9, which is this particular computer. But the universe address will be, what did I say it was? 88, I think it was. And remember, we created Artnet Universe 1 over there. Over here in OLA, it's set up as Artnet Universe 1. So that is there. We'll OK that and save that. And theoretically, if we go here, we'll create a fixture. So now we'll go to the simple desk, and I've already got the device defined there, or that light defined. There's its 8 channels. I'm in universe 1. You can see we can address multiple universes. So with that, if I pull up the master and pull up the blue, and the green, and the red, and the white. So this is happening through my home network. The computer that you're seeing this on is connected to my home Ethernet, which is the same network that the Wi-Fi of the Pi is on. So normally, if you were doing this for an actual show in a venue or something, you wouldn't want to be using the house Wi-Fi. You'd want to take your own router or your own Wi-Fi access point and set up your own Wi-Fi. But for this just demonstration, I'm just using my home Wi-Fi. Anyway, so that's all well and good. But the whole point of this is to use multiple universes.
So for that, we'll bring this guy in, and I'll just quickly connect up some power from my bench power supply. And we'll connect that to the USB to DMX converter that's connected to the computer and power that on. So that is set to channel 1 as well. So it's going to be addressing channels starting at 1 and going up until it runs out of channels. At the same time, you remember this guy is also set to channel 1. But because they're in different universes, they will react to different stimuli.
So back over here, I will create an RGB panel, assign it to universe 2 starting at 1. This particular one happens to be green, red, blue is the pixel order. It's in zigzag, and I think that's right. Sure. And if we go back to the simple console, look at universe 2, it's defined itself all green, red, blue, green, red, blue, green, red, blue.
So if I start firing some of these up, we should see some pixels starting to light up on the matrix. And of course, we can go pages ahead here. Oops, it's a little bit too far. So we'll start picking up some pixels from other places here too. But as you notice, messing around in universe 2 on this one has no effect on this other light in universe 1, and messing around with that has no effect on this. They're completely separate, they're coming from the same computer, and we could go further if we wanted to. We could add more universes. This particular program, Q8 controller, handles 4 universes.
So 4 times 512 would mean that I've got 2048 channels. If I'm talking to just RGB, we could get a maximum of 682 pixels that we could control in RGB mode just out of this program. However, there is, in the standard, there's an unlimited number of universes. This program just happens to address 4 because it's a basic freeware program. Professional lighting consoles can address, the sky's the limit, I think. I guess the sky's not quite the limit. Artnet can address up to 256 universes, so 256 times 512, you do the math if you want. There are newer standards that allow more than that, but pretty much anything, including this, should be able to do up to the 256 universes.
Which is way beyond the scope of the playing around that I'm doing here. And of course, for each universe, you'd need your own one of these guys. Although, I think there are 2 serial ports on here. I don't know if that software can talk to 2 serial ports or not, but regardless, these Pi Zeros are only $15. This and this driver board is, you know, probably less than $1 in bulk, so it's a pretty cheap way of getting into it. I don't know if I would advise professionals to use some of this really cheap homebrew stuff, but if you're making a one-off, if you're doing, you know, parade floats or something like that. I know a lot of the guys that do the big Christmas lighting displays in their yards or the big Halloween displays in the yards, they use DMX sometimes. They use a lot of other possible things, but DMX is one of the things that they'll use, and Artnet is one of the things that they'll use. So this is probably a very reasonable thing for that, or for a band on a budget, or for a DJ starting out, or community theater, or any of these kind of applications. I think this would be a great way of going about it. Of course, to do it properly, or at least a little bit less janky, you probably want to put this all in a case. So here is one that I printed out and put a chassis mount XLR connector on it. That should fit down in here. This is nothing fancy. I just took this one that I downloaded, dropped it into Tinkercad, chopped off the parts I didn't want, added pieces that I did want, put a hole for the XLR connector, put the screw holes in the wrong place so I have to drill more screw holes. But I'll put that in there. And I've taken one of these insulation displacement connectors and put a piece of ribbon cable onto it. I don't need all 40 pins, so I just use a piece of 12 conductor ribbon cable. So that can go on there. I've taken the pins off this so I can solder that onto the ribbon cable, and then solder wires instead of using screw terminals, just solder from there onto the XLR connector, and it should be good to go. So I'm just going to get busy doing that, and we'll come back when I'm done. It's pretty straightforward soldering all in all. Right, there's everything together, I think. I'll just plug that in. Oh, I made that connector face the wrong way. Oh well, functionally it doesn't matter, it's just a little awkward. Snap that guy down, power him on, and let's see if it still works. Master up, red up, yes, green, blue, white, woohoo! Happy days. So this makes it a lot cleaner. I've still got a 3D print a lid for this box. I'm not sure whether I want to go to the effort of reprinting that just to get the holes in the right position. That worked. So I think that is a neat little project. None of it is unique to me. It is all just gleaned from various different articles. As I said, I'm going to put a whole bunch of links down in the bottom there if you want to try this or some variant on it. It was a pretty straightforward project. The hardest part was actually just soldering the wires onto those holes, because I had to clean them out a little bit because I had to take the pins out from before. But we're all good now, and it definitely works. I am thrilled by this. Strobe mode, sure, we don't need that. This is cool. I like it. And I hope you enjoyed that too. Found that interesting or entertaining or informative or something. Questions or comments down below as usual. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.